Hello and good day to everyone. My name is Muhammad Rifki and I am an executive MBA student at IPMI International Business School. This semester, one of the most interesting subjects in my MBA program at IPMI is corporate finance, which I'd like to share with you. This made possible by the one and only Professor Roy Sembel, who is a professor of financial economics and an investment practitioner. I believe we learn corporate finance directly from the cream of the crop, Prof. Roy Sembel. I'd like to share with you a mind map of what we learn in corporate finance class. I learned a lot of this section and I'll share a little bit on this mind map. The first is related to financial management. Because we are discussing corporate finance, so we are debating the implementation of financial management. We can define financial management as the optimal use of internal and external financial resources to create significant and long-term value. We can divide long-term value creation into profit maximization and wealth maximization. Profit maximization can be related to list timing and sustainability. We are learning about investment and financial instrument that provide a high risk compensate high return, low risk low return, and no risk means the instrument provide risk-free rate. Wealth maximization can be reflected in the stock price and an efficient market from the perspective of investor. As part of our introduction to financial management, we are also learning about 5 business essentials based on the book What the CEO Wants to Know, written by Professor Ram Charan from Harvard Business School, which include cash, with the main important things of the cash flow being incremental cash flow, which is why people often say that cash is king. Profit margin related to profitability, velocity, and then growth, and customer focus. GCG is another term for good corporate governance, which we are also discussing. TIRIF is the essential of GCG. We can also say transparency, accountability, responsibility, independency, and fairness. We are also talking about principal and agent issue caused by asymmetric information, moral hazard, and conflict of interest. We learn about time value of money after learning about the basic of financial management. This is where we talk about compound interest. They say compound interest is the world eighth wonder. He who understands it earns it, he who does not request it. Compound interest is simple but not simple in practice. It is critical to understand that the world eighth wonder is based on little more than elementary school math that we all understand. It is quite simple, but unfortunately, it is difficult to implement. When one earns compound interest, the interest earned on the principal balance is reinvested and generates additional interest. Compound interest is also used to calculate the future and present value of money. As part of the time value of money, we are also learning about the 72 rules, which is formula used to estimate how long it takes for an investment to double in value while earning a fixed annual rate of return. The rule is calculation and shortcut for determining how long it takes for an investment to double in value. The simple calculation is 72 divided by the annual interest rate. The third mind map topic is capital budgeting. One of the purpose of capital budgeting application is to provide sensitivity analysis prior to determining decision criteria. The other important aspect of capital budgeting is estimating cash flow, which can be done in variety of ways. The most common capital budgeting method includes initial cash outlay, periodic operating cash flow, and terminal cash flow, all of which help us to calculate the payback period. However, payback period has some flaws, such as not taking into account the time of value of money the required of return, or all cash flow from the project. As a result, there are other methods to take into account all cash flow, time value of money, the time of value of money, and required rate of return, such as net present value, or NPV, profitability index, or PI, and internal rate of return, or IRR. Then, we all talk about security analysis in the next interesting topic, such as stock, bond, and so on. The first is fundamental analysis, which is commonly used before deciding what and why to purchase. Warren Buffett, an investor role model, stated, "Know what you are buying and buy what you are familiar with." This is why fundamental analysis has become so important. Fundamental analysis can be conducted using a variety of approaches, including domestic global economics and market sentiment. Investor must be aware of and comprehend both good and bad news. Then, there's market ratio analysis using various methods, such as earnings per share and industry comparative analysis, and so on. The following step of company analysis, which can be accomplished by comparing in the intrinsic value of the company to the market price, and then calculating the enterprise value, price to book value, and so on. The following is financial statement and ratio analysis, which include profitability analysis, such as gross profit margin, operating profit margin, net profit margin, and EBITDA analysis. The other is the liquidity or solvability ratio, which include the current ratio, debt to equity ratio, and so on. Finally, we are learning DuPont analysis, which consists to several components that help us calculate expected return on investment through a breakdown analysis of net profit margin, return on asset, and financial leverage. Another analysis to supplement in fundamental analysis is, of course, technical analysis, which help us determine the timing to decide the investment analyze momentum and reversal timing, whether it is in the support or resistance area, in an uptrend or downtrend, and so on. Another topic I'd like to discuss in this mind map is capital structure and corporate restructuring. Based on the Mogliani-Miller theorem, we are learning about the relationship between firm value and debt ratio in capital structure. The fundamental theorem states that in the absence of agency costs and asymmetric information, an efficient market exists, and the enterprise value of a firm is an effective byproduct. In the topic of corporate restructuring, we are learning about financial distress and leverage buyout or LBO. In relation to the finance distress, we are learning that there are two types of financial distress outcomes. Turnaround opportunity and permanent problem are two examples. For a turnaround opportunity, we must restructure our financial asset and operation. For a permanent problem, the impact of financial distress may result in either private liquidation or legal bankruptcy. Another aspect of corporate restructuring is leverage buyout or LBO mechanism, in which a company acquires another company by borrowing a significant amount of money to cover the acquisition costs. The assets of the company being acquired are frequently used as a collateral for the loan. The following topic we discuss in class is fraud risk management. In this topic, we learn about typical frauds such as corruption, conflict of interest, bribery, and illegal gratuities. The second is asset misappropriation for cash, inventory, or other asset. The third is fraudulent financial reporting, which is caused by financial statement manipulation due to insufficient treatment. We are also learning about the fraud triangle, which consists of three components: opportunity, pressure, and rationalization. So if we are talking about fraud risk management, in order to eliminate fraud, we must also follow the good governance principle. In terms of company cooperation, that is why in this mind map, I attempt to connect the process management to the GCD principle. In the previous topic, we learned about efficient market hypothesis, in which we can learn that the market can be assessed as efficient when the price reflects available information. And thus, the financial assets are at the price, there are neither too high nor too low. All available information include historical trading data about report as well as public information. Finally, we learn about dividends, including their purpose and the factors of that influence a company dividend policy. At the end of the day, the investor and shareholder perspective can play an important role in the worth maximization, which is why I try to reconnect the purpose and relevant factors that may impact the dividend policy to the investor and shareholder perspective as well.
Prof. Roy Semble said, lesson in class, it's okay to make mistake. You will learn from your mistake. It's very interesting and memorable in my mind. Thank you for taking the time to watch and listen to my video presentation. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and share.